All right, shall we get started? Today's makeup look will be on District 9, which is green. And for my YouTube peoples, if you're ever curious about what I'm using on my face, it'll be listed down in the comment box at the end of this video. So Theodore Robert Bundy was born on November 24th, 1946. After more than a decade of denials, he confessed to 30 murders he committed in 7 states between 1974 and 1978. Bundy's true victim total is unknown and is likely significantly higher. I actually read on some research sites that there were people who thought that his victim count was 100 or higher. If I get cut off, it's because TikTok doesn't like what I'm talking about. On your end. Sorry. I've got to cut in here real quick. I got to give you this trigger warning. We talk about rape, sexual assault, dead bodies, necrophilia, a lot of gruesome things. If that's not okay with you or that's triggering for you, then you need to not be here at this moment. Bundy was regarded as charismatic and handsome, traits that he exploited to win the trust of both his victims and society as a whole. Made him much more dangerous than any regular serial killer. He often feigned injury or would impersonate law enforcement. His most popular law enforcement officer that he liked to impersonate was known as Officer Rosalind. We're not sure how he came up with that name. Hold on, I know I put it in here. Found it! I'm back. Sorry, I found it. He engaged in necrophilia and decapitated at least 12 victims and kept their severed heads as mementos for his apartment. It's a little much, Ted. In 1975, Bundy was arrested and jailed in Utah for aggravated kidnapping and attempted criminal assault. He engineered two of the most dramatic escapes to this day and was finally caught for good in 1978. Bundy was executed at Florida State Prison on January 24, 1978. Anne Rule, who personally knew Bundy, described him as a sadistic sociopath who took pleasure from another human's pain and the control he had over his victims to the point of death and even after. I can't get my notes to sit right, sorry. He described himself as the most cold-hearted son of a bitch you'll ever meet. Honestly, I don't know, because I kind of feel like maybe Dahmer kind of took that from him, or even H.H. Holmes, because he did not give a fuck about anybody. No, John Wayne Gacy will be done next week. Polly Nelson, a member of his last defense team, wrote Ted was the very definition of heartless evil. Like, his own defense team knew he was guilty, but they had a job to do, so they did it. Ted's mother, Eleanor Louise Caldwell, claimed to have been seduced by a war veteran named Jack Worthington, who abandoned her soon after she became pregnant. Some family members expressed suspicion that Ted was fathered by Louise's own father, Samuel Cowell. Wouldn't that be some shit? However, in 2020, Dr. Dorothy Ortho Lewis confirmed that Ted was not actually fathered by his own grandfather. Which, I mean, is, I guess, good, but from the research that I could find, which was not a lot to say about Louise, she was abused by her dad. So thinking that he might have done it was not too far-fetched for anybody to believe. For the first 3 years of his life, Bundy lived with his maternal grandparents. They raised him as their son to avoid any of the stigma of him being born out of wedlock. He believed his grandparents were his parents and his mother was his older sister. Bundy did eventually discover the truth as he got into his late teens. He resented his mother his entire life. Bundy exhibited disturbing behavior at an early age. And I mean, like, early age, okay? Louise's younger sister, Julia, recalled awakening from a nap to find herself surrounded by kitchen knives and a smiling three-year-old's head. Just standing over her with knives, like... 3 years old! Three! Sorry, I didn't blend that very well. Bundy's grandfather had some mental issues that I kind of wonder if they weren't eventually just passed on to Ted. As he got older, he would often speak about aloud to unseen presences, and his grandmother would occasionally undergo electroconvulsive therapy for depression. Because, you know, in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, that was how we handled mental health issues. I mean, fair enough. Fair enough. He admitted to being a peeping Tom as early as the age of 9. Just peeping in little girls' windows from school to see what they looked like. At 9. 9. Like, that's so wrong. I feel like there was so much in his early life. Like, when I was researching this, I feel like there was so much in his early life that should have honestly just told people that he was not okay. And he needed help. But, you know, back then, mental health issues were just swept under the rug. You didn't talk about mental illness at all. And... In 1951, Louise met Johnny Bundy at an adult singles night at Tacoma's First Methodist Church. They married, and Johnny officially adopted Ted. Johnny and Louise went on to have 4 children of their own. And Johnny would say that... Hi. Would say that he tried very hard to include Ted in family events and in being a family. And he didn't want it. No matter what Johnny did, it was just not enough for him to, I guess, be a part of the family. Let's see. Bundy excelled at downhill skiing, and classmates from Woodrow Wilson High School stated that Ted was well-known and well-liked. Although when Ted went to trial, he tried to state that he never really knew how to make friends and never really talked to anybody, and he didn't have any friends. Elizabeth Klepfer's daughter, his first girlfriend, Molly, wrote about how Bundy was inappropriate with her, including indecent exposure and sexual touching disguised as games. We hear a lot about that when it comes to child sexual predators playing games with their victims, and it's not okay. It's never okay. If you know of somebody that's happening to you, or it's happening to you yourself, please tell somebody. It's not normal. It's not okay. That's not how daddies love their little girls or any of that shit. So, Bundy said he attempted his first kidnapping in 1969 in Ocean City, New Jersey, but did not kill anyone until 1971 in Seattle. However, he later told a psychiatrist, when he was arrested, that he killed 2 women in Atlantic City while visiting family in Philly in 1969. Hello, Natalie. Shortly after midnight... Oh, sorry. Rule and homicide detective... Oh, I cannot speak English today. Robert Keppel believed he might have started killing as a teenager, but his earliest documented homicides were committed in 1974 when he was 27. There was evidence that, I guess, I don't have the, factual articles to back this up, but I had read somewhere that he admitted to killing, a classmate of his or something to someone. But like I said, it was very, it was very jaded information that I couldn't get, a full story on, because that would have been too easy, apparently. To give facts or articles to back it up. It's just the way it is. Shortly after midnight on January 4th, 1974, Bundy entered the basement apartment of Karen Sparks, 18. He bludgeoned her and sexually assaulted her. She survived but suffered permanent physical and mental damage. Basically, she was brain damaged afterwards. Early morning of February 1st, he broke into the basement room of Linda Ann Healy. He beat her, dressed her, and took her with him. He did not confess to Linda's murder for quite some time. It's sad. But there are actually quite a few of the victims I'm going to talk about today that were just... they were never found. On March 12th, Donna Mason, 19, left to attend a jazz concert and never arrived. April 17th, Susan Rancourt disappeared. There really wasn't a whole lot of information on where Susan was or where she was going when she was taken. Some say she was a runaway. Some say she was a college student. Some say she was a high school student. I couldn't find, like, a whole lot on how she disappeared. May 6th, Roberta Parks left her dorm to have coffee with friends and never arrived. June 1st, Brenda Ball disappeared after leaving the Flame Tavern in, forgive me if I say this wrong, Buren. June 11th, Georgianne Hawkins, which is the first one that I really ever remember hearing anything about was, I mean, I wasn't alive then, but like when I would do this research on stuff like this for psychology class and other classes, that was the first one I really, like when I was doing my research now, that I recall ever hearing anything about. Georgianne Hawkins disappeared while walking down a brightly lit alley. Bundy said he strangled her and spent the night with her body. Now, what was crazy about this is we have somebody who's missing. We know she's missing. So police are, baby, go lay down. Police are all over the place, right? All over the place. And he still managed to sneak into this crime scene unnoticed, collect her earrings and a shoe that had been lost during the struggle, unobserved. Nobody questioned him being there or even seemed to really notice that he was there, which is, like, crazy to me because, again, highly active crime scene. Obviously, it wasn't being observed very well. He confessed to visiting her corpse on three occasions after that. He told investigators that he kidnapped Janice Ott and Denise Noslin and made one watch while he murdered the other. Now, I know their remains were found, I believe, together. So they were together. Thank you for the likes, Natalie, that they were together when they were killed. It's crazy to me. Sorry, give me just a second here. September 6th, two hunters found the remains of Ott and Noslin. An extra femur and several vertebrae were identified as those of Hawkins, but they were never able to find much more of her body and remains than that. 6 months later, forestry students discovered the skulls and mandibles of Healy, Rancourt, Parks, and Bell. Mason's remains were never found. In August 1974, Bundy got a second acceptance to the University of Utah Law School and moved to Salt Lake City. Yeah, well, he's doing all of this. He's studying to be a lawyer. Which is why, I mean, like, he was his own attorney at his trial, but he had a defense team because, you know, he didn't actually finish law school because, you know, murdering people's bad. But yeah, he was studying to be a lawyer. While he's killing all these people. I mean, more power to you, I guess. Oh, thank you for the gift, Harley. On September 2nd, he raped and strangled a still unidentified hitchhiker in Idaho. I'm not entirely sure how we got from Utah to Idaho. They really didn't give a lot of information beyond that because that was the only killing that was ever, like, recorded in Idaho. Babe, will you call the dogs? On October 2nd, he abducted Nancy Wilcox, 16. He said she was buried near Capitol Reef National Park, but her remains were never found. It's astonishing to me that you know where he took them, and he gives you, like, he basically, like, drew them a map of where these bodies were, but you couldn't even find like bones. That's crazy. It's crazy to me. It's just crazy. On October 18th, Melissa Ann Smith, 17, the daughter of the police chief of Midvale, disappeared after leaving a pizza parlor. He murdered the daughter of a police chief, and they still couldn't catch this guy? You would think, like, if anybody was gonna solve this crime, this murder, it would be the police chief, especially when his own kid is kidnapped. But no, that was too easy, apparently. It's just sad. Her body was found 9 days later. Postmortem exams indicated that she may have remained alive for up to 7 days after she disappeared. And honestly, like, when I was researching this, to think about that, like, it's one thing to find the body of the person that you love that went missing, right? And know that they were killed and there was nothing you could do to save them. Which, I mean, it's sad, obviously, don't get me wrong, but I feel like it would hurt me more to know that I could have found them still alive within that 7 days if I had just figured it out. Like, that would be heartbreaking to me. This is why I can never be like a cop or an ER nurse or a lawyer or anything, because I'm super sensitive to other people and I would just like spend... Sorry, I cannot talk while I spray that. It does not taste good. I would spend the whole time just like freaking crying all the time. I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I don't know how people who do it do it. Like, if you are an officer or a forensic criminologist or anything, I'm sorry, because I could not imagine doing what you all do. I would be crying nonstop, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, because, yeah, that's me. That's just me. On October 31st, Laura Ann Ami, so on Halloween night in 1974, Laura Ann Ami, 17, disappeared after leaving a cafe just after midnight. Her body was found by hitchhikers on Thanksgiving Day. Both girls had been beaten, raped, sodomized, and strangled with nylon stockings. It wasn't just enough to kill him. He had to torture him first. Years later, Bundy described his post-mortem rituals with the corpses of Smith and Ami, including hair shampooing and application of makeup. And honestly, that just makes me feel really weird because I'm doing my own makeup right now. But that's not the worst of what he did when he would visit them again. He was trying to mask the smell of decomposition. Gross. Like, honestly, at that point, you should just, like, it wasn't enough to kill them. No, he had to continue to disrespect them after they were dead. Like, that's just not okay. I mean, obviously, killing them is not okay, but you know what I mean. Years later, November 8th, Bundy approached Carol DeRanche, 18, at Fashion Place Mall in Murray. Now, the story is, with this one, that... he lured her to his car by pretending to have an injury, and then the injury, like, when he got her into the car, or to the car, he pushed her in, obviously losing the charade of being hurt, and in the struggle that she fought back, and in the struggle, he accidentally put the handcuffs. This is not the time. Come here. Hold on, my dog is... There you go. Sorry, my dog, she'll whine until I pick her up. I was trying to ignore her. And then he accidentally put the handcuffs on the same wrist. So that, I love getting live invites. Blood and Alive. Come watch my live. Sorry, chick, I'm busy. But, So she was able to get away from him. She ultimately did escape from him. She is the only one that I was able to find or read about that did escape Ted Bundy alive. Says a lot. Later that night, because, you know, he's pissed, he lost his first intended victim, so he's pissed off, so he goes out hunting again. And that's the other thing. I hate that we call it hunting, but that's basically what it is. He went out hunting again later that night, and Deborah Kent, 17, disappeared after leaving a movie theater production. In 1975, he moved his crime activity from Utah to Colorado. So now we've got crimes in Utah, we've got crimes in New Jersey. No, sorry, we've got crimes in Seattle, and now we are in Colorado. So, new set of crimes, new crime base, freaking fantastic. January 12th, Karen Campbell, 23, disappeared in Snowmass Village. She was killed by blunt force trauma. For those of you that don't know what blunt force trauma is, it's basically taking some hard object and hitting somebody over the head with it repeatedly until you kill them. Usually crushing the skull is what happens. March 15th, Julie Cunningham, 26, disappeared while leaving her apartment. He beat, raped, and strangled her. Denise Oliverson, 25, disappeared from Grand Junction while riding her bike on April 6th. Exactly a month later, on May 6th, 12-year-old Lynette Culver disappeared from her body. He drowned her in his hotel room and disappeared from her school. He drowned her in his hotel room and threw her body in a river. Now, there was a lot of argument that Kimberly Leach, who we will get to in a little bit here, was his youngest victim. But obviously, Lynette Culver, who was 12, is his youngest victim. It doesn't matter. It's sick and wrong, no matter who the youngest was or who the oldest was. It's fucked up. It's not okay. June 28th, Susan Curtis vanished from Brigham Young University. Her murder was Bundy's last confession. So he was sitting on death row, about to be executed, and he confessed to the murder of Susan Curtis. At least her parents got closure before he died, I guess. And I don't even know how to respond to that. That's so messed up. The bodies of Wilcox, Kent, Cunningham, Olverson, Culver, and Curtis were never found. So none of his none of his Colorado victims were ever identified. Bundy was arrested on August 16th, 1975, and escaped on June 7th, 1977. Now, he basically pretended that he needed to go to the bathroom and escaped out the bathroom window. I don't know, like, I obviously wasn't alive back then, but I don't know what made any policeman think, yes, let's let this statistic killer go to the bathroom completely unsupervised. Give me a second, I can't talk Indigo Islander at the same time. Like, what made you think? Obviously, somebody wasn't thinking. He escaped on June 7th, 1977. On January 15th, I don't know who sent me something. January 15th, 1978, Bundy entered FSU's Chi Omega sorority house. Beginning at 2:45 a.m., he beat Margaret Bowman, 21, beat, strangled, tore the nipple of, and bit the buttocks of, and raped with a hair mist bottle, Lisa Levy, 20, broke the jaw of Kathy Kleiner, and Karen Chandler suffered a concussion, broken jaw, loss of teeth, and a crushed finger. Chandler and Kleiner survived. Tallahassee police said the attacks took less than 15 minutes. 15 minutes to kill three people, kill two people, and severely injured two more. That's insane. February 19th, Kimberly Leach, 12, went to the principal's office to pick up a purse that she had lost. She never made it back to her classroom. 7 weeks later, her partially mummified remains were found in a pig shed. She was raped and had her throat slit. Could you imagine being a parent and finding your 12-year-old's body? in a pig shed. Like, that tells you just how little he cared about human life at all. A pig shed. That's all it was. A pig shed. That's horrible. It's disgusting. He was arrested again on February 12th, and 10 of his victims today are still unidentified. 10 people are still in unmarked graves because they don't know who they were. Meaning that when they found the remains, they were too degraded to do anything with. They couldn't get DNA evidence off of them. They couldn't do anything with the bodies that they found because the remains were so degraded that there was just nothing they could do for them. Also, let's not forget that all of his Colorado victims, except obviously for the Chi Omega sorority house victims, their bodies were never found. That's just soul crushing to me because it's 10 families that went on living their lives and they have no idea what happened to their loved ones. Like, I could not handle that. Other possible victims of his include Ann Burr, who is 8 years old. This is just a straight list because they really didn't have a lot of information on his Wikipedia or any books that I checked out. I could not really find anything to kind of back up or even really be able to tell you what happened to these particular victims to make them think that they were Ted Bundy's victims. But obviously somewhere they felt that the MOs matched up with shit he did. So we have Ann Burr, 8, Lisa Wick and Lonnie Trumbull, both 20 years old. Susan Davis and Elizabeth Perry, 19, both 19. Rita Curran, 24. Joyce LePage, 21. Rita Jolly, 17. Catherine Devine, 14. Sandra Weaver, 19. Melanie Cooley, 18. Shelley Robertson, 24. Nancy Bard, 23. Debbie Smith, 17. So it's not just that the victims that I could find research on, obviously there are others that they think he committed, but they couldn't prove and he never confessed to. And honestly, when he would talk about the crimes that were committed in trial, he would often talk about them hypothetically, like, oh, well, if I did do this, or if the killer did this, then he probably did this. He would never come out and admit that he actually did any of the things that they accused him of. But he kind of screwed himself because when he would talk about it, he would obviously get excited, which I hate that fucking word for this case, but he would get excited about it. And there would be a visible reaction to it because that's what serial killers are. They get off on knowing they've hurt innocent people. And I just, it's so fucked up. It's so fucked up. I just don't know how anybody can just be like, have that little value for human life. I don't understand it. I mean, serial killers, they're wonderful to learn about, especially in like a psychology setting, because it helps you to understand that not all human minds work the exact same way. However, it is also, I'm sure, because it is for me, it takes a toll on my mental health, which is why I decided I could not do this every day, like the discussion of serial killers every day on my YouTube channel. I was like, I gotta mix in some just normal makeup or whatever, because it's so freaking depressing. And it takes a toll on you mentally, because you're just reading all of these gruesome and gory things, and I don't think people realize how much that takes out of you when you do it, because you're basically living through these crimes again with these people. And I always want to be as respectful as possible, like give you the straight facts without going into any too gory detail, because obviously I don't want to upset anybody, but also because I don't want to be disrespectful to the victims. I don't want it to seem like they don't matter just because this was so many years ago and they're dead, because they still matter. They were still human beings that, yes, I am. They're still part of the, yeah, see, flag. They're still part of the, you know, the equation. They're still important. They're just as important as you and me or any living person. But that's pretty much it on the case of Ted Bundy. I will stick around for a few more minutes while I finish getting makeup and jewelry on. If you have any questions that you would like to ask, now is the time to ask them. I hope you enjoyed today's segment. And next week, we will be doing John Wayne Gacy. And then the week after that, I am doing Jeffrey Dahmer. I've already got research and everything signed up. So, lined up. Jeez, I cannot speak today. My youngest is transgender. I am a lesbian. I'm married. Where did I get my flag? Spencer's at the local mall.